Greetings to all of you this morning in the name of the Lord Jesus. It's a joy to gather together as we are this morning to sing praises, to worship the Lord, to look into the scriptures, and to encourage one another. So welcome to everyone. I assume most of you are here regularly, but if there are visitors among us that I don't see, welcome especially to you as well. I'm going to invite you to take the Mennonite hymnal and turn to number 2. This is a very short psalm of 2 lines each, but a very powerful psalm. And so I would like to say a few words before we sing it. It's a song of praise, and the book of Psalms was the songbook of the people of God and ends with Psalm 150 with these last verse, the last verse. Let everything that hath breath praise the Lord, praise the Lord. I want to do something this morning that I don't usually do, but I'm going to read this psalm and make a few comments before we sing it, because I want you to catch the significance of this psalm. All peoples that on earth do dwell, sing to the Lord with cheerful voice. Him served with mirth is praise for them. Notice the cheerfulness that's being called for, the joy, the gladness. Mirth even carries the idea of gaily or with laughter. His praise foretell and to come before him and rejoice. Verse 2 is a call or a reminder that God is the creator and that he's our shepherd. Know that the Lord is God indeed. Without our aid, he did us make. We are his flock. He doth us feed, and for his sheep, he doth us take. And then again, a call to enter God's house with praise and joy, and to always bless the Lord. Oh, enter then his gates with praise, approach with joy his courts unto. Praise loud and bless his holy name always, for it is seemly so to do. And then finally, that God is good, and his truth is always firm and enduring. For why? The Lord our God is good. His mercy is forever sure. His truth at all times firmly stood, and shall from age to age endure. This is a call to sing with full volume, and just sing with joy to the Lord this morning. And all of you who come from the camp, good for you to stand. invite the ushers to come forward.
Yeah, thank you for that powerful and meaningful moment.
Let's worship the Lord with our guests. Let's pray. Father, thank you for the gift of this day. Beautiful, joyous summer day. These days, you know, it's a different dream, and we thank you for being for that. Thank you for the gift of song. And thank you for the gift you give us to live out our day for our work. And thank you for the opportunity to give back to you with some of the things you've given us. And I pray you bless the gift you give for your work, for your service, for your locally, and for your work.
Thank you. Morning. Welcome to Kingdom Mennonite Church. We do have some visitors. It's good to see you. I won't identify you. It'll be obvious soon enough. Welcome to everybody. It's good to be here this morning. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we trust that you have a message for us this morning. I pray, Lord, that your spirit would reign here. I pray that your spirit would speak through me. Lord, I pray that in what I have to share, you would be honored and glorified, and that your truth would be told. Thank you, Lord, for your holy word. Thank you, Lord, for this place where we can gather. Thank you, Lord, for your church. Bless our time together. In your name, I pray, Lord Jesus. Amen. Okay, as you probably all remember, we are going through the Bible. We're on, I think this is like lesson number 75 out of 100, so we're 3/4 of the way through. And then maybe we'll just start all over again and go through again. Today's is lesson text is from Acts chapter 10, verse 48, and through to chapter 11, verse 18. And it shows how God works. God is about his business, and nothing can stop him. Today's lesson is about, today's text is about the expansion of the word, expansion of salvation, the indwelling of the Holy Spirit to all nations and all peoples. And it's not, it is done by evangelism, but in today's lesson, today's text, there's a heavy influence or a heavy presence of angels, visions, and voices. So we'll see how that occurs. Okay, I'd like to start, obviously, at the beginning. Actually, I think I misspoke. I said it's from Acts 10:48. It is not. It's all of chapter 10. My bad. So, chapter 10 of Acts, starting with verse 1. And this is the story of the first Gentiles upon whom the Spirit falls. This is the vision of Cornelius. There was a certain man in Caesarea called Cornelius, a centurion of what was called the Italian regiment, a devout man, and one who feared God with all his household, who gave alms generously to the people and prayed to God always. About the ninth hour of the day, he saw clearly in a vision an angel of God coming and saying to him, "Cornelius." And when he observed him, he was afraid and said, "What is it, Lord?" So he says to him, "Your prayers and your alms have come up for a memorial before God. Now send men to Joppa, and send for Simon, whose surname is Peter. He is lodging with Simon, a tanner, whose house is by the sea. He will tell you what you must do." And when the angel who spoke to him had departed, Cornelius called two of his household servants and a devout soldier from among those who waited on him continually. So when he had explained all these things to them, he sent them to Joppa. Okay, I'd like to stop there. This first vision is, as it said, it is to Cornelius, who is a centurion. So he is not a Jew, he is a Roman, and he is the first, he and his family will be the first non-Jews to have the Spirit descend on them. And when I was preparing for this, the thought that came to my mind is, okay, it's got to start somewhere. I understand that, but why Cornelius? Why him? And I don't want to make too much of this particular bit of information, but centurion is a word that doesn't occur in the Bible very often, but it occurs three times. There are three mentions of centurions. One is at the cross, well, one is of course today. One is at Jesus' crucifixion. There is a centurion standing at the foot of the cross, which is a little bit of an anomaly. A crucifixion detail is a pretty menial task. A centurion is not a menial position. Centurion would be roughly equivalent to a captain in today's parlance, today's military. So he's not a small personage. But nevertheless, at this particular crucifixion of three men, two thieves and one person that's hard to describe exactly what his crime was, Jesus, is a centurion. And that centurion, as he watches the crucifixion, comes to the conclusion that truly this was a righteous man, and even in some translations, truly this man was the Son of God. So this was a particularly, I guess I would say, observant centurion. Earlier in Matthew, a centurion also is identified again. And this centurion is also, as Cornelius is, a godly man, devout, and he is the one that goes to Jesus for the healing of his servant. And Jesus says, all right, I will come and heal your servant. And as you may remember, this centurion says, no, that's not necessary. You don't have to come to my house. I understand that you are essentially the God of heaven. You can make this happen just by saying so. And Jesus commends him for his faith. He says, not even in all of Israel have I found such faith. This centurion knew that Jesus could command whatever he wanted, and it would be so. So I'm not saying that Cornelius is these other two centurions. I find it interesting that this centurion with this kind of character, it occurs three different times in the Bible. And today, this centurion becomes the one, he and his family, the ones chosen, to be granted the gift of the Spirit. It is notable that he would be considered by the Jews, the Romans were occupiers, he would be an enemy, he would not be, they would not be indifferent to his personage, who he was, what he represented. He represented Rome. A centurion, probably most of you know, is, as I said, kind of equivalent to a captain in today's army. Centurion is the same word as we get century from. It means 100. And so he would have been the captain of 100. So as I said, not an important person in the Roman army. But he was a righteous man. The angel says to him in verse 4, your prayers and your alms have come up for a memorial before God. So God has recognized that this is a good man, a man that is worthy of his blessing, his attention. Another thing that I found kind of interesting is that centurions were not chosen for their warrior mentality. They were actually chosen for their, for their consideration, that they were not the kind of guy that you might necessarily want to lead you into battle, but they were the kind of guy that would stand behind you when you were in battle. So they were trustworthy. The Roman army chose them specifically for that reason, that they knew that they would do their job when the time came. And I think that speaks well for him and for what God is calling him to, what God will shortly be calling him to. His response to the angel's, what the angel tells him to do, is immediate. He does not think about it, he does not think, do I really want to do this? Did I really see what I thought I saw? Instead, Cornelius immediately gets two of his household servants and also one of his own soldiers, who is, it is noted, is a devout soldier. So these are all men coming from a devout household, and they are sent to Joppa to get Peter. Now, coincidentally, Peter, I'm sure, is a very willing evangelist, but going 30 miles with people he doesn't know who aren't Jews might not be something, you know, that he'd be inclined to do. But of course, God is on top of all of this. This is the second scene, I'll say, in today's text. And it is Peter's housetop vision. The next day, as they went on their journey and drew near the city, Peter went up on the housetop to pray about the sixth hour. Then he became very hungry and wanted to eat. But while they made ready, he fell into a trance and saw heaven open, and an object like a great sheet bound at the four corners descending to him and let down to the earth. In it were all kinds of four-footed animals of the earth, wild beasts, creeping things, and birds of the air. And a voice came to him, "Rise, Peter, kill and eat." But Peter said, "Not so, Lord, for I have never eaten anything uncommon, anything common or unclean." And a voice spoke to him again the second time, "What God has cleansed, you must not call common." This was done three times, and the object was taken up into heaven again. Okay, I'd like to stop there, actually. So coincidentally, as these men are coming from Joppa to get Peter, he is having this vision, which is essentially, he doesn't really know what it is, what it means at that point, but Peter is being asked to do something that sounds like it could not come from God. He's asked to kill and eat essentially what are unclean animals. It doesn't give us a real good description of what the animals are or are not, but his response is that he will not kill and eat anything that is unclean and never has. So this is, he's told, yes, you should do this, and what God has cleansed, you must not call common. And he's shown this three times. And of course, three is a number that's somewhat significant in the Bible. Things almost always happen in threes when God's involved, it seems. I mean, I'm not trying to make too much of numerology. But it is interesting to notice that when Cornelius sent the three men, well, I guess that was also number three occurring there. But it's a sign that Peter can trust this vision. Now, it's interesting to me that this vision, considering what Peter's going to be asked to do, that this vision is not about the thing he's going to be asked to do. He's going to be asked to accept Gentiles, but he's not shown that. He's shown instead something that's seemingly somewhat unrelated. And it reminds me of the way that Jesus taught. He taught very often in parables, and they were not exactly, you know, Jesus did not come right out and say things. He taught in parables, and I think this is kind of a similar idea. It's a way of getting Peter used to the idea before he's confronted with it, which he will be confronted with it very, very shortly. As Jesus said, hearing that they might not hear, seeing that they might not see, and that is why he taught in parables. And Peter would have, by this time, been fairly familiar with Jesus' parables. And so this time, you know, he probably was wondering what it was about. As a matter of fact, that's exactly what it says. Now, while Peter wondered within himself what this vision which he had seen meant, behold, the men who had been sent from Cornelius had made inquiry for Simon's house and stood before the gate. And they called and asked whether Simon, whose surname was Peter, was lodging there. While Peter thought about the vision, the Spirit said to him, "Behold, three men are seeking you. Arise, therefore, go down and go go with them, doubting nothing, for I have sent them. And stop there for the second. So just as Peter's having this vision, which he has to wonder what it's about, what it could mean, the answer is, behold, is right at the gate. The word behold is used twice just in those few verses to show that this was immediate. That Peter saw the vision, woke, you know, came out of the vision, I guess, thought about what it could mean, and at that same moment was answered by the presence of these three men at the gate, these three Gentiles, non-Jews. Okay, then Peter went down to the men who had been sent to him from Cornelius and said, yes, I am he whom you see. For what reason have you come? And they said, Cornelius the centurion, a just man, one who fears God and has a good reputation among all the nation of the Jews, was divinely instructed by a holy angel to summon you to his house and to hear words from you. Then he invited them in and lodged them. So by doing that, Peter essentially accepts who they are, what they're there for. He lodges them, so he's not saying, I don't know what you're here for, I don't trust you, go back where you came from. No, he accepts what he's been told. He doubts nothing, which is what God is telling him. Because I think the part that I don't want to miss here is how important the whole concept of clean and unclean was to the Jews. Us reading about it 2,000 years later from a completely different context, a context where we are encouraged to go out into all the world. The Jews were encouraged, not just encouraged, it was demanded that they not do that they stay within their own little enclave, that they remain amongst the Jews, that they remain pure. All of their 600 whatever laws that they had were for the purpose of setting them apart, not mixing with folks like us, with people who were unclean, with the Gentiles. So Peter's being asked to step outside of everything he's ever been taught and everything he knows. Now I'd like to read actually though from Mark chapter 7 verses 14 to 23, because while this is somewhat of a revelation for Peter, this is what he had heard his master, Jesus, teach. This is Mark chapter 7, verse 14 to 23. When he had called all the multitude to himself, Jesus said to them, hear me, everyone, and understand. There is nothing that enters a man from outside which can defile him, but the things which come out of him, those are the things that defile a man. If anyone has ears to hear, let him hear. When he had entered the house away from the crowd, his disciples asked him concerning the parable. So he said to them, are you thus without understanding also? Do you not perceive that whatever enters a man from outside cannot defile him because it does not enter his heart but his stomach and is eliminated, thus purifying all foods? And he said, what comes out of a man, that defiles a man. For from within, out of the heart of a man, proceed evil thoughts, adulteries, fornications, murders, thefts, covetousness, wickedness, deceit, lewdness, and an evil eye, blasphemy, pride, foolishness. All these evil things come from within and defile a man. So Jesus has prepared his disciples, and in particular, in this instance, he has prepared Peter for this idea of cleanness and uncleanness going away. Now, so it may make you wonder, okay, the unclean thing, the Jewish dietary laws, and this particular rule about not mixing with Gentiles, these are going away. So what was their purpose? Why did they ever exist? And this is, I don't want to dwell too much on this, because hopefully we've had a little bit of teaching on this before. But in the beginning, God set his people apart because the world was a wicked place, and God needed a place, essentially, if you want to think of it as a nursery, he needed a place where the Jewish people could become one people, where they could become his people and learn what it was like to be godly people. So that he did it for that reason. He did it so that they would understand what sin was and what obedience meant and how they could be done. So they needed something to obey if they were going to learn obedience. So that was another purpose of the law and of these rules. And going back even further, I suppose, and a little bit more, less spiritually, some of these were simple rules of hygiene. I'm going to tell you this anyway. Pigs are the number one animal that was out of bounds to the Jews. And what I learned we raised pigs when I was a kid. What I learned from raising pigs is that their digestive system, we'll just try to keep this as tidy as possible, their digestive system is similar to humans. And so that certain of the things, if you are not very specific, not very particular about your hygiene, that you can catch things from pigs that you cannot catch from virtually any other animal. For what it's worth, it's called zoonotics, and probably at least the Mars are aware of that idea. But in any case, so there was this hygiene aspect. And so if you're not careful and not clean, stay away from pigs because you can catch stuff from them. Okay, I lost my page, but I will find it. So all of that to say that Peter has been introduced to the idea of accepting Gentiles, and so he willingly goes with them. And this brings us to the third scene. Peter meets Cornelius. And the following day, they entered Caesarea. Now Cornelius was waiting for them and had called together his relatives and close friends. As Peter was coming in, Cornelius met him and fell down at his feet and worshipped him. But Peter looked at him, saying, "Stand up, I myself am also a man." And as he talked with him, he went in and found many who had come together. Then he said to them, "You know how unlawful it is for a Jewish man to keep company with or go to one of another nation. But God has shown me that I should not call any man common or unclean. Therefore, I came without objection as soon as I was sent for. I asked them, 'For what reason have you sent for me?'" Because at this point, Peter is aware that he's being called. He understands that God's working, you know, behind all of this. But at this point, Peter still doesn't know why. He has no idea. His Cornelius' vision really wasn't shared with him. And so Cornelius retells his account. So Cornelius said, "4 days ago I was fasting until this hour, and in the ninth hour I prayed in my house. And behold, a man stood before me in bright clothing and said, 'Cornelius, your prayer has been heard, and your alms are remembered in the sight of God. Send there to Joppa and call Simon here, concerning his Peter. He is lodging in the house of Simon the Tanner by the sea, and he will speak to you when he comes.'" So now Peter, Cornelius has told his side of the story. Peter has told his side of the story. They've kind of compared visions and instructions from God, but it's not really exactly clear exactly to either of them why they're here. Peter wants to know why he's here. Cornelius knows that he was told to call him, but he doesn't know why. He knows he's going to tell him something, and this is what Peter said. "Then Peter opened his mouth and said, 'In truth, I perceive that God shows no partiality, but in every nation, whoever fears him and works righteousness is accepted by him.'" So this is, again, I want to emphasize how significant this is. In every nation, that had never been true before. This was the first time that this had ever happened, and was happening to the Jews of all people, the most isolated or isolating people that there were. Other nations would mix, but the Jews, as you remember your Old Testament history, were almost demonic about not mixing with other people. And God had been the reason for that. God had told them so. When they went to the promised land, they were supposed to kick everybody out chasten them for not doing it the way that he said, not doing it as completely as he said, because they were bad influence. They were still at that nursery stage where bad influence was something that they readily succumbed to. From there, Peter goes on to give essentially the gospel message. He explains to Cornelius and his family what Christ did, why he came, why this is important, and how by accepting Christ they can be saved. Jumping down to verse 44. While Peter was still speaking these words, the Holy Spirit fell upon all those who heard the word, and those of the circumcision who believed were astonished. As many as came with Peter, because the gift of the Holy Spirit had been poured out on the Gentiles also, where they heard them speaking with tongues and magnifying God. Then Peter said, "Can anyone forbid water that these should not be baptized who have received the Holy Spirit just as we have?" And he commanded them to be baptized in the name of the Lord. So this is kind of the happy ending to our story. The Gentiles, not knowing why they were there, heard the story, and the Spirit came upon them. As it says here, the six men that Peter, the six witnesses that Peter had had the good sense to take along with him, saw what happened, that Gentiles received the Spirit just as they had, God's chosen people, and they were astonished. But Peter is doing a pretty good job of tracking, you know, with God's narrative here. Peter realizes what has happened and the significance of it, and he says, "They received the Spirit, we received the Spirit. We received baptism, they need to be baptized. They need to become full-fledged believers, no condition." And so that's what happens. And that's why I say this is the happy ending to our story, except verse 11, or chapter 11. Now the apostles and brethren who were in Judea heard that the Gentiles had also received the word of God. And when Peter came up to Jerusalem, those of the circumcision contended with him, saying, "You went in to uncircumcised men and ate with them." Well, obviously they weren't up to speed on this. The apostles and brethren who were in Judea heard that the Gentiles had also received the word of God, which sounds really good for them. And instead of focusing on that and saying, "Way to go, Peter," you know, they go back to their concerns about eating and drinking and who you do it with. Now, I've been pretty hard on them, on the Jews, because, but in all fairness to them, this is something that would be completely new to them. And in all fairness to them, they were Jews. This was their strict law. What unstrict laws do we have that would keep us from accepting somebody else? And you know what those things are, even if we, you know, don't care to list them right now. But I think we have to admit, or I have to admit, that there are things that when I see them in other people, I say, I mean, I think I know who they are. I think I know that they are not saved. I think I know that they are not Christians. And I think I know that I should ask forgiveness for that. And I think I know that that's God's grace. The dietary things, you know, what would it be for us? You know, maybe it's piercings and tattoos and all those things that, about the culture that we see, we can scratch our heads about. Maybe it's, if you want to go dietary, maybe it's alcohol or things like that. But God, of course, desires deeply to reach out to those people every bit as much as he desires to reach out to us. Did we come from a privileged background, as the Jews did, where they could kind of fit right in? Or did we come from a background like some other people do? It's much harder, it seems, to bridge the gap and to become one of God's children. Peter goes on to explain the visions, what happened, what his vision was like, what Cornelius' vision was like, the fact that they came Peter gave the gospel to them, and that the Spirit came. And I'd like to read verses 15 to 18. Okay, this is Peter. I'm going to back up to... This is Peter talking. Who will tell you words by which you and all your household will be saved. And as I began to speak, the Holy Spirit fell upon me, as upon us at the beginning. Then I remembered the word of the Lord, how he said, John indeed baptized with water, but you shall be baptized with the Holy Spirit. If therefore God gave them the same gift as he gave us when we believed on the Lord Jesus Christ, who was I that I could withstand God? And when they heard these things, they became silent. And they glorified God, saying, and God has also granted to the Gentiles repentance to life. God wants, of course, to reach out to all people. We understand that now. We understand it much better than they did then. They will go through, as you remember, a number of missteps. The Council of Jerusalem needs to be called so that they can kind of hash out which of the Jewish laws to keep and which to throw away. Some still think of themselves as like Messianic Jews, and some of them have are willing to bring that up. It's notable that Peter, who talks about his own perfectness, so to speak, in being adherent to all the Jewish laws, and Paul, who was of course a Pharisee of the Pharisees, that those two, the two of the first to give up their Jewishness, the two that were perhaps the most Jewish, or had the most credit built up in their Jewishness account, all two of the first to give it up. God is calling us today, this week, to go out into a world that may seem pretty unclean and pretty common. I can't help but think of where I'll be going tomorrow, and back to the factory, and the guys that I work with. And God loves them very dearly, and so can I walk past anything without in some way trying to witness what God has done for me and what God is very earnest in doing. Heavenly Father, Lord Jesus, we came to this earth with a purpose of redeeming fallen men. We are all, Lord, unclean, and we are all common. But you have created us all, and you have created us in your image. You desire, Lord, for us to be like you. You desire for us to be the reflection of Christ. I pray, Lord, that we would endeavor to do that, and that as a part of that, we would endeavor to reach out as you did. Help us, Lord, give us the strength to reach a fallen. Help us, Lord, not to consider quite so much our own comfort or even our own misgivings. But Lord, as Peter did, help us to doubt nothing but to trust in you entirely. In your name, I pray, Lord Jesus.
You see two pages in front of you, and you notice There's three verses. You sing to the end of page two, you go back to the middle of page one and pick up the next verse. And after you sum the three verses, you just flip the page, and then there are two more verses to be sung. Think of the words. Archbishop Carl Sestak said when he saw this, "This is the message that all of our congregations and all of our people ought to share." It's a profound message we see in life. Let's try and see if we can sing this morning.
Thank you.
Okay, this is the time when we take the opportunity to share with one another the blessings and prayer concerns that we have.
Raise your hand and the mic will be brought to you.
This is Caroline. You can just keep myself and Leah in your prayers on Friday. We will be heading to DuPont Children's Hospital to do her biopsy. Her liver numbers have been really good, but they still want to just do the biopsy to sort of make sure they're not missing anything. I have never been to DuPont. This is as local as they would let us go because of her being a pediatric patient. So we just pray for me as we travel down Friday morning. We have to be down there by 7:15.
Where's DuPont?
Delaware.
Delaware. That's a scary place.
Hi, this is Derek. I would just like to thank everyone who came to the coffee house last night. It was a big success. It was really fun. Thank you for all your donations.
This is James. Just another comment. I'd like to commend the congregation for the many ways in which I observe and see you reaching out to other people in the activities of the church and in your daily lives. I think you as a congregation, young and old, are really serious about sharing the love of Jesus. You might be interested in knowing that this is happening all over Lancaster Conference these days. There's a prayer gathering that meets at Landis Homes once a month, and this past week when it met, there were three pages of material of things that are happening to be prayed for all throughout Lancaster Conference and churches. And so this vision of seeing new life, in many ways, is happening. The Spirit is at work. And so I just thank God.
This is Loretta Dockley, and I'm happy to report that Emily's surgery was a success. She's healing well. She's limited as far as being able to maneuver and that kind of stuff, but she's doing very well. And also that I'm happy to announce that she is engaged to Michael Parker.
This is Lena Brown. I'd like to mention two things. Dan and Emma Rice, who are serving 3MM in Laos at the Water Polo Factory, are flying to Pennsylvania, U.S. anyway, today at their own expense because of a crisis with close friends of theirs. And so they're coming to spend 3.5 weeks. Anna especially mentioned, pray for their trip. It's grueling for the little girls. It's a long, long journey. So as they fly, Dan and Anna Rice.
Dan and Anna Rice.
Rice. Little girl, sorry. I'm not even sure, 3 and 5 or 3 and 6, something like that.
Okay.
The other thing I wanted to mention was Mike and I yesterday attended the funeral of Roy Brubaker. Roy Brubaker and his wife Hope were missionaries a number of years ago in Kenya and Somalia, and more recently had an organic farm in Mifflin Town. And Roy was very much involved, loves the earth, and believes in being a good steward. Was killed through a farm accident, and leaves a big hole in that way. So just pray for Hope and the children in this house.
And this is Heidi Carmel, and I just wanted to say thank you in person for all your support and prayer for the last few months. It is great to be back.
This is Ricky, a couple weeks late, but I want to thank each one who helped at Bible school. We had a good turnout of kids, and it was, yeah, another good weekend. Just thank each one that helped us.
I have one announcement, actually. And I guess this is an opportunity where we as a church can reach out into the community. This morning, before church started, before Sunday school, I got a call from a local woman, and that she and her son had their house, they were renting a house, and it was sold out from the apparently. It was sold, and the landowner, the landlord wanted to sell the house. They weren't aware of that. They sold it. So they've been living in a campground locally somewhere, and they were hoping that we could help them. She did a little checking around, so she did some math for us. Red Roof Inn is $67 a night. She's 62 years old, so I'm feeling like she doesn't need to sleep on an air mattress anymore. I spent one night on an air mattress, and I'll spend $67 to avoid that. But 1 week is, it's 1 week till they get their apartment, their house. So times seven, that's something that the mathematicians in the group can figure out, but it's about $500. So something that we as a congregation can consider. They need to know right away, because they want to sleep somewhere tonight. I would encourage the finance committee to talk to me about it afterwards, and anybody else that would like to tell me something, to talk about it, maybe what I'll do is after this, I and the finance committee can meet back in the toddler Sunday school room. So anybody that has anything you'd like to weigh in on that, or if you'd like to contribute, that'd be great too. Okay, that's coming first. Heavenly Father, I thank you for a church body. I thank you for this congregation, Lord, that we can support one another. Thank you, Lord, for the blessing that that is, and perhaps that we even maybe are tempted to take for granted. But Lord, when we hear of other people who do not have a church to reach out to, we realize how much this body means. I pray, Lord, that you will be with Carolyn and Leah as they go down to DuPont. Be with them, give them a good journey. Thank you, Lord, for the success of the coffee house, that we were able to support each other and support the youth in that. I thank you, Lord, for a good prognosis for Emily as she recovers, and a great good news of her engagement. I thank you, Lord, that Heidi and the baby whose name I forget right now, could be with us this morning. I thank you, Lord, for a successful VBS. I thank you, Lord, that you are reaching out throughout the conference, that you are calling your people to be available, to help, to reach out into the world. So as we support one another, Lord, help us not to forget that there is a world out there that needs you, and we are your hands and your feet. Help us, Lord, be willing to be used. I pray your blessing on the Brubaker family at this time of their loss. In your name I pray, Lord Jesus. Amen. Okay, and would you stand for a benediction? Heavenly Father, you have sent your Son to be our salvation. As we go forth from here, help us, Lord, to count the cost, to realize what has been given to us, and what we, as your children, can offer to the world. Be with us, Lord, this week. Help us to be bold and listen, and help us to be generous in our giving and in our helping. In your name I pray, Lord Jesus.